6 o'clock. At 6 o'clock. I know. Now it should work.
And so I repeat again that there will be a meeting of the GV for the best young researchers presentation at 6 o'clock. And no, at 4:30. At 4:30 outside this room, because in this room there will be a workshop on research data management. And there is yet another announcement that some of you may need the originals of the invoices, so you can take it from the reception from the conference office. So I know that they were distributed by email, but I realize that some of you need originals of course. So,
welcome back. Our keynote speaker is Rob Etima, currently from the United States, Colorado State University, and started his career in Auckland in New Zealand, and then after doing his PhD there with a very distinguished sediment transport expert, went to the United States and went to Iowa, where he was for many years staff member, ultimately head of department. Then he went to Wyoming and then went to Colorado State University. In all that time, he'd been very active. He'd been the recipient of a number of awards and honors, and he's been the editor of what some might refer to as the journal in our field. So I'd like to welcome him here today. He's talking on, I've lost it, ice formation processes and concerns in hydraulic engineering.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes, it's working.
Thanks for the opportunity to speak to you this morning, and I'm glad to be part of a session with Tomasz and Ira talking about ice and hydraulic engineering. Tomasz and Ira will go more detailed than I will go. I will do a fairly high-level flyer of ice concerns. So, first point I want to make is that water is a material. We sometimes forget this in hydraulic engineering. Water material, the material properties of water influence hydraulic engineering. In many parts of the world at different times, water turns to its solid phase, ice. Ice adds complexity to hydraulic engineering, as I will show. And the purpose of my lecture this morning is to essentially give you a wide overview of the various ways that ice complicates hydraulic engineering. And the message is that if you forget about ice, you will run into problems. This figure here shows a good extent of the northern hemisphere that experiences at least 1 month per year of average temperature below the freezing temperature here. And here we are in roughly in Warsaw, so we see we're in the middle of much of it, well embedded in this area that experiences cold weather. In addition, there are many parts of this area that have mountainous. So with mountains, we not only have cold, we have high pressure differences, potentially large pressure differences. So temperature changes, high pressure, and groundwater issues, which are common in mountainous areas, create real problems for us in hydraulic engineering. So hydraulic engineers, I've often found in my 35, 36 years of experience in cold regions engineering, cold regions hydraulics, often unprepared for this character, Jack Frost. Jack Frost is the personification of ice concerns, and Jack Frost is a mischievous fellow who pops up when you least expect him. Actually, it's the hydraulic engineer who's the mischievous fellow who tries to get away with things that he shouldn't. For example, this is the Susitna River. This is the monthly flow of the Susitna River over winter, or over a year, I should say, 2012 to 2013. This low flow period here is when it's winter, or when the ice cover forms, and then we get an ice breakup, a dynamic ice breakup for that particular year. The Susitna River is here. I'll come back and refer to the Susitna River quite frequently. on the Susitna River at the moment is perhaps the last large dam under design in the United States, about 220 meters in height, very controversial. Anyway, the idea of the dam is to change this hydrograph to put a more steady flow through here. And so high flow and ice conditions are a recipe for problems, as you'll see. As you've heard already from Professor Majewski with regard to the Vistula River, and I'll come back to the Vistula River from time to time. So Jack Frost overlooked, complicates things. And here is out in Montana, where it was, the Missouri River, a number of years ago, talking with ranchers who were rather puzzled as to why the river was eroding their land. Something is happening under the dam ice, they told me. And so what is it? It was a project I was involved with for a number of years. This reach of the Missouri River is on the Fort Peck, below downstream of Fort Peck, hydrodam. So my lecture outline is an introduction, which I've just covered, touch on what water's material properties, touch on ice formation processes, breakup processes. I'll do this very quickly. And again, my intent is to give a broad overview of this. Look at ice concerns and hydraulic systems, and I break them into two: mountainous terrain, where we have to consider pressure differences, and lower terrain. Then we'll look at ice effects on fluvial morphology. Fluvial morphology and sediment transport is a major consideration here. And in this, I'll also include vegetation effects. And if we have time, I'll look at a problem, a hydraulics problem in a large lake, Lake Michigan, an ongoing problem, and quite an attractive problem anyways. So water's property, and I've summarized the main points before I do each section, so you get a sense of what the main points are. Water is a simple, relatively speaking, small, relatively speaking, molecule. Its smallness and simplicity and its polarity enable us to be here today. We're about 70% water. And if the molecule of water was not so small, we would not be here today. Water has a unique phase diagram, which I'll show. Material properties that we'll touch on are density, freezing temperature variation, change from liquid to solid, thermal conductivity, I'll skip that a bit, and strength I'll touch on very briefly. This subject brings hydraulics very quickly into strength of materials, brings it into geomechanic concerns, and quickly gets multidisciplinary instructors I should have. So water, this is a water molecule, is a very small polar molecule with two pairs of electrons cause the hydrogen molecules to, atoms I should say, to be at this particular angle. And when it goes from liquid through solid and melting, it changes its form in interesting ways, unique ways. Again, water is a very small molecule. If it was a big molecule, we would not be here today. Densities of water and ice are concerned, and I'll touch on these very quickly. This is a phase diagram of water. Water produces more crystal forms than any other material that we know, these different types of crystals. Diagram is pressure versus temperature, vapor, liquid, and solid. In terms of hydraulic engineering, we live in this and work in this area here, by and large, dealing with water and its particular structure and uncertainties to ice crystal form 1H, a hexagonal form here, which by its nature is lighter than the liquid phase. This is very, a rather unique feature of water. Just imagine if the solid phase of water was heavier than the liquid phase. Our ecology would be so different. We would be quite different, I think. Water also has a very unique freezing curve. It has a negative slope. Most materials, this curve goes this way, which means as the pressure increases, the freezing temperature decreases. So this is very important in hydraulics, where we're dealing with variations in pressure, pipe systems, hydropower systems, and so forth. Again, we'll be focused more on around here in the talk today. Hydrologists play around here a little bit more. Looking at freezing temperature and its depression with pressure, the plot here are some curves. And this is a typical height range for mountainous projects and mountainous terrain. Typical pressure range of where we are playing is in here, gray zone. But if you look at more broadly, you get a trend like that. Does pressure effects on freezing occur in nature? Yes, it does, particularly under glaciers. This is an interesting paper. You have an over-deepened glacier, so deep here, the pressure is greater somewhere in here. As it moves through, the pressure is released, so you have similar problems in some of these types of glaciers. Does depression of freezing temperature with regard to the effect of pressure occur in hydraulic systems? You bet. Sure it does. You look at some of these pipeline systems with big drops, big head differences. Just imagine this operating in a cold temperature, the pressure variation. So we start maybe near freezing, or maybe near zero, and then as the pressure goes up, we may go something like that, and we come across, and then we may, as the pressure comes down, we may go down, so we have problems of things freezing up on us in pipelines like this. We have a interesting density versus temperature profile like this. So the water is its most dense at 4 degrees Celsius, as you probably know. And then we may get super cold. Water, any material to change phase requires seeding. So there has to be a little solid phase, part of that phase, available to seed, like a snow crystal in the case of ice. And we drop down here from this structure to this structure, and ice is less dense than by and large, than water. And the phase diagram, you look at it in three dimensions, it really quickly gets complicated for water. Much of hydraulic engineering, like most hydraulic engineers, don't bother to think about this. When they design projects and core readings, they quickly run into problems, as I'll illustrate. Effect of pressure on viscosity, whether it's kinematic or dynamic, doesn't really matter. We play in here, we're not in these big trends, we're not working in these pressures typically in hydraulic engineering. So there's some variation, but we work in a narrow range. This is normalized relative to zero pressure and variation of viscosity. So looking at ice formation, that's a brief coverage of material properties. I'll come back to strength soon. Formation of rivers, ice formation in rivers and lakes, main points I want to convey. We need now to consider thermal and phase change processes, something which we often don't do in hydraulic engineering. Ice can take on several forms. It's the same basic crystal structure, but it grows different ways and forms overall in different ways. Frazzle ice, anchor ice, border ice, so-called thermal ice, like an ice sheet that grows as vertically as the cold air above sucks out its energy, latent heat. Alpha ice, or Russian nalya, probably the term nalya is more appropriate than alpha ice, since Russia has more to deal with cold weather. Types of ice cover formation. Accumulation cover, most rivers start this way. Large lakes accumulate, they don't freeze through formal ice formation readily. Thermal, small lakes, small reservoirs, eventually rivers and small lakes, large lakes, I should say, it should be large. No, that's right, it should be the small lakes that grow thermally. Accretion, the various ways where ice spills or icings occur, so I'll show. Ice insulates, but actually ice is more conductive thermally than water. It's just that it cuts off the heat loss to air and wind above. Ice insulates, particularly when it's covered with snow. Snow is 1/40th of the thermal conductivity of liquid water, so snow is particularly good insulator. Ice alters flow distribution, both vertically and laterally. Freeze-up flooding, from engineering we're often concerned about jam flooding, so freeze-up jam flooding, typically occurs in higher water streams, up in the watershed, as I'll illustrate, in small rivers, not always. Low water streams and watersheds have freeze-up jams. A topic at the moment, a contemporary topic in this subject of hydraulics, is the development, as I'll show, of settlements in mountain valleys, which look very nice, close to ski resorts, and they're realizing they have problems with winter freezing and flooding. I'll show in due course. Thermal and mixing processes. How does the ice cover form? I'm a little embarrassed to say, we don't really know. We have an idea, but that idea in the last several years has been proven rather wrong. This is a figure, a famous figure, and I've superimposed here the yellowish outline, a process which we think actually occurs. We start off above freezing degree, get cooling, we get slightly super cold, we need some sea crystals like snow or ice from some form dropping in. We get frazzle formation, we get something called anchor ice, which I'll go into more. And this anchor ice is very hard to see. I guarantee that it occurs in the bed of the Vistula River on a very cold winter. But the Vistula River is so muddy you don't really see it. You have to go to small clear mountain streams to see it form. The anchorite detaches, form slush together with some browser, and these drift down and accumulate and form an ice cover. And this, one of the great, and what I'll do is I move along with this talk, point out where I call the frontier of knowledge, or in my case, the frontier of ignorance, is. And this area here, how this actually forms, how the mixing occurs, how supercooled water, which is lighter than the water at 0 degrees, is by turbulence mixed to the bed and feeds crystals here that grow. I should say ice crystals in supercooled water are very sticky. They stick to things. They stick to trash racks, for instance, on watering tanks. This is a very recent temperature in blue. I should have had the different colors and water level in red. This is taken from a small stream, Flat Creek in Jackson, Wyoming. And this is one of the first, this was taken last winter, one of the first times we were able to track in great detail the temperature variation, water temperature variation, in blue here. What I draw your attention to, this is 0 degrees Celsius. Note the supercooling, about half a degree. Nothing much happens because it warms up during the daytime very quickly, and because there's not enough ice seed crystals around. But we get down here, you can see supercooling, just a fraction of a degree, 1 or 2 hundredths of a degree Celsius. And then the water depth goes up. We get this, this slush formation, ice accumulation covers, then it warms up a bit. And we get more of these, and you can see the water depth fluctuations following the daily cycles of cooling of the water surface. We have the instruments now that we can measure these. We still have to learn how to work with them properly and interpret their data. Eventually, an accumulation cover forms, like this one on the Yellowstone River near Glendale, Montana. We have a full cover, and then we start to get thermal ice growth. We make a snow, it's rather irregular, and then the thinner parts grow faster, then it levels out. But you can see the accumulation patterns, ice drifting down from upstream. Eventually, it grows to become a thermal cover. We can do a nice heat balance, latent heat release here, and conduction through the ice cover, heat loss to the atmosphere. I won't go into the details of heat loss coefficients, but we take into account all these different typical heat loss and heat input mechanisms. We use something called the Stefan equation, which talks in terms of accumulated degree days of freezing to calculate the thickening. I won't go any more into that, just to say that this part of the of ice engineering is quite well understood. What's often forgotten in hydraulic engineering, particularly fluvial engineering, is the banks. The banks are made also of material. And the corner of the bank, the top of the bank, is where we get greatest heat loss from the land. So this area, like along here, where this is on the Missouri River, the ice is out, we get a large heat loss. So geotechnically, the soil here goes through 3-4 cycles. Also, we may have channel shifts, thanks to the variation in ice cover thickness. So the banks in wintertime, many rivers are particularly weakened, which affects the morphology of the channel. Very quickly, there's some images of Frauzel. This is on the Mississippi River, a nice, really circular ice disk behind a wing dam. Ice Frauzel is very small crystals, maybe 5 centimeters, 0.5 centimeter thick. Anchor ice, very hard to see, and I'll come back to it, but if you pick it out of the water, you can see how these crystals have grown. This is in the Laramie River. This is the Missouri River in Montana. Good thing about ice is it's thick enough you can drive across it. So here we're in a pickup truck with a crack here. I'm glad to say it's in the windscreen of the truck, not on the ice. So you can drive across and take a shortcut rather than driving maybe 30 kilometers up to the nearest bridge and back down across. This is a small stream. You see how irregular the ice cover forms here. This is a stream, a braided river in Siberia where we get extensive up ice, nayad growth. And nayad ice is very layered, like a sedimentary core. You see layers of blocks up and the laminar flow over the ice, it freezes, blocks up again, you get layering and layering occurring. This layering is very important. Alf ice is very important for gravel bed rivers. This is in Alaska. This is an early photograph of some of these formations here, very large, and given the winter conditions. Alaska. In mountainous areas, where I put a little bit of emphasis in my talk, things get more complicated because we have groundwater to deal with. So this is the Susitna River, the middle reach of the Susitna River. In the middle of winter, snow on the ice, you see we have open water lead through here. This is because of groundwater and hyperreic flow coming into the channel, you see a bit here too, which prevents or inhibits, and this gets very cold, ice from forming through here. These leads, we're realizing, are very important ecologically. They emit light and oxygen into the water, and if you like fishing in winter time, these places are great for fishing, I can tell you. Here you have another view here. Alpha ice again, this is a lead, and sometimes hydraulic leads form. The ice cover doesn't quite freeze over because of hyperreic flow is still coming into the water column, but what you see here, this is the ice cover, and below you see a band of anchor ice, that stuff I showed before. So one of the, and I'll come back to it, but one of the questions in our field is, why is this anchor ice formation so robust? Another one is, why have we overlooked it? And how does it contribute to ice cover formation? So the Susitna River is very clear in wintertime, so you can look right down into the bed. Further details on Susitna shows how complicated things are under the ice cover, or can be under the ice cover. This is taking a cross-section of depth and ice formation. Here we have an ice cover, this is a squish image, and we have anchor ice slush accumulation, and the flow is pushed to one side during the ice conditions. Briefly, ice cover breakup, main points here. We have two forms, thermal decay and dynamic or mechanical failure of the ice cover. Thermal decay is where ice just sits there, warms up, and the ice basically rots, as we say, in place. Dynamic breakup is when we get melt up, runoff with melting occurring or rain, and we get a hydrograph coming down the channel and it physically breaks up the channel, the ice cover, and so we have ice and high flow, very abrasive on channels. Dynamic breakup is most dynamic on north flowing rivers, like the Vistula River in Poland. You have a river that flows north. In Russia, you have some of these magnificent big rivers like the Yenisei and Ob, which flow north, very dynamic in springtime. And so breakup ice jams form, and these often cause flooding along large rivers, like we know with the Vistula River from Professor Majewski's. And these typically occur on bigger water, higher water streams, downstream of the watershed. So in considering ice breakup, we need to consider how the cover weakens in time, going through there from December through March, or if we catch it when it's thinner, it might break up. So mechanical properties of the ice cover are important. Ice sheet, strength properties are important. This is a guide for how thick the ice can be before you can do certain things. The weakest form of ice failure is in flexure, bending upwards, because the crystal structure at the top are finer grained, at the bottom they're columnar and not well connected, particularly when they're warm. So here you see ice flexural failure as ice has been pushed against a lid in Nebraska. You see it bends up like this. The crystal structure here, not as strong as the bottom. Ice is also very, as broken ice, small ice pieces, ice rubble is an interesting material. I won't go into too detail. These are well-known, more Coulomb geomechanics sort of circles we draw for determining the strength behavior of granular materials or soils. Ice, here we get the effect of freezing, pressure effects. On contact points, the pressure goes up momentarily and we get melting, and the pressure releases, we get a bond here. So bonding occurs between these crystals, we get almost like a cohesive behavior. So depending on how strong you pressurize this rubble, you get an effective angle of the internal resistance, which is higher than the equivalent if you had gravel or something, same shape and size. So the material behavior of ice can be complicated. Look quickly at ice effects, ice concerns in mountainous regions, and again, we're living along this curve here. So we increase the pressure, the freezing temperature decreases. We reduce the pressure, all of a sudden we run into problems. So what I want to do is run through a few examples and show some case study examples of problems. In these particular classical hydraulic engineering situations, hydropower plants, pipelines, tunnels, and so forth. And we'll look at some other problems very briefly occur at lower elevations. So, as we know, mountainous areas are important as water sources, snowmelt, water from lakes and so forth, but we have to deal with colder air, greater pressures, and groundwater, which complicate things. So a number of years ago, I was involved extensively with a diversion system through the Sierra Nevada Mountains in California through to Nevada, and we've had a mix of open water channels and tunnels and pipes. Solution of the problem. So classic problem with hydropower is one problem is that we get ice freezing, anchor ice and frazzle blocking trash racks, so we block the thing. Another problem is when we bring in some isolated water, but the pressure is very high, and all of a sudden the pressure drops and we get ice formation at the bottom and the out in the draft tubes and blockage down that end. I won't go into details on that because we don't have time. Pumping, you pump uphill, you increase the pressure, then decreases, you get blockage at the outlet of pump systems. Siphon systems, we draw in water, mating water with ice, drops down. As it drops down, the pressure increases. We go along, and then as we go back up, the pressure decreases, and we get ice formation at the outlet, you get blockage at the outlet. And I'll show some cases soon. One with siphons, often in mountainous areas, we run pipes up and down through things. We have a similar system to your digestive system, your colon, in a way, where ice accumulates, you get an ice bolus which lifts up and then exits, but then after a while the black backs up lower, you get more accelerated ice formation, you get increased blockage occurring here. Tunnels, problems with leakage of water into freezing conditions, blockage of tunnels, snowfall into tunnels and so forth. So a range of isolated problems for tunneling. Here are a set of examples. This is a case of a trash rack blockage for a pump storage scheme, Yards Creek in New York, say New Jersey. This is the intake up here. This is, to give you a sense of scale, this is where a platform where you would walk. You can see how ice blockage has bent in those trash racks, how the trash racks are missing here. In fact, these trash racks went down the penstock and ended up wrapped around a turbine. It's a very expensive problem. A small turbine in the Aleutian Islands, frazzle blockage at the outlet. A siphon, again in the Sierra Nevada mountains, about a 100 meter drop along, horizontally and back up. And at first, you notice these ice boluses porpoising out, dolphining out. Then they slow the flow, and all of a sudden you get a major blockage occurring in this pipeline system. So these pipeline systems, siphons and so forth, are all very well to design included in your system, but if you don't know what the ice is going to do, you run into problems. This is a tunnel also in the Mill Bull system, feeding ice, thinking you just pass it through the tunnel, but also frazzle and anchor ice, you get ice accumulations, as you can see here, and ice blockages occurring in the tunnel. This is a major irrigation diversion tunnel, irrigation and hydropower. Winter flooding, as I mentioned before, this is a creek, Flat Creek in Jackson, Wyoming. Jackson, Wyoming is a very expensive place to live. Very expensive homes around here. Beautiful location. People forget about ice flooding in wintertime. So we have ice flooding driven by groundwater flows coming in. And here is a topic of research too, because people put in all sorts of nice structures to improve the habitat, habitat rehabilitation. Those structures, as you can see here, complicate ice problems and create ice problems. So we have a debate going on now as to the extent to which these stream rehab structures actually aggravate and lead to flooding during wintertime. The sketch here gives a sense of how the flow blocks and water is pushed out. So a topic of research is the effects of whole regions on rehabilitation structures. At lower elevations, and I'll go through this fairly fast and then move to fluvial, and I'm not sure if I'm going 54 minutes, I think. Okay. I'm doing okay. Maybe I'm going too fast, I'm not sure. Ice jams, ice loads on bridge, loads and riprap embankments, ice problems for spillways and gates, navigation difficulties for major navigation systems like the Mississippi, Ohio, Illinois system in the US, fluvial channel shifting, effects on vegetation. I'll put these two later when we talk about ice effects on morphology. So this is a nice drawing of a bridge, and you see ice coming down, you get what's called water ice growing out, some accumulation growing up on the banks. And the problems that we have with bridges are ice blockages and ice loads on piers, sometimes uplift on decks. The deck can be lifted off the bridge. So a major concern is spacing of piers and elevation of the deck, so allow enough flow way through so we don't get blockage. This is a blockage that occurred last winter in Wyoming on the Bighorn River. And you can see here the ice backed up and flooding around the town. And it drifts, doesn't go all the way down the river, but it drifts for a reach or so. This one here, you know, might rely on your good finger to be sure I don't screw it up. But this is ice rafting, showing, can you give you a sense of how we did tests in the river, put markers, you can see green gravel, cobbles, anchor ice lifting it off the bed. And then it just drifts downstream. Typically it dumps them and hits a bit of turbulence or a rock ripple area. One more. This is showing you, give you a sense of the size of the material that can be moved by anchor ice. Again, once it builds up, it lifts off. So this is a piece of anchor ice drifting down. You'll see a gravel cobble here, moved by ice during ice freeze up. So you get a sense of the size soon as the hand goes in to pick it up. That's the size of material that can be moved. Now it doesn't move that far, but in certain areas where the ice cover doesn't form over, you get night after night, ice picks up gravel and moves gravel. So it has a great disturbance effect on any armoring coverage of the bed. That's it. Also, in an ice, anchor ice particularly likes to attach to coarser material like gravel, but it also gets embedded in bed forms. So if you look along the Laramie River, a convenient outdoor land, the river, you'll see sandy reaches, and then you'll see anchor ice in the wake of a dune, and as the dune moves, you get the anchor ice included, embedded in the dune, and the dune kind of freezes there. And it affects the dynamics of the water. These, I should say, are all relatively low flow situations. These are not flows. If you look at the typical annual or multi-year hydrographs for the Laramie River, the flows are not strong enough to lift or move the gravel, the coarser gravel. It's the ice that does the job. So this is an area of active research. It's an area of concern for fish biologists. If you're a fish of a very small size, you can swim among the crystals. If you're a fish of a big size, you can brush them off, but if you're a certain range of size of fish, you can get trapped in this stuff. So the concern is the fish kills associated with anchor ice. Anchor ice moves a lot of sediment in due course, and this is a boring of ice in the Missouri River, downstream of the Laramie River. And you can see you bore a hole through the ice cover, and it's not just pure ice, you'll find a lot of sediment embedded in the ice. This is coarser sands and finer gravels. If you go to a river like the Platte River through Nebraska, which the Laramie feeds into before Missouri, you'll see a lot of slush formation. And can you hear me? Right, I may not need this. I'll keep my hand free. You see a lot of slush formation. So this ice formation is a major effect in sediment transport. Not the big events, but it moves the coarser material and keeps things moving, weakens armor covers. Looking at ice effects on channel cross-section, we have a sketch like this, and this is an area where more work is needed. But ice shifts the thaw wave. You can see the shifting occurring here, erosion occurring here, similar areas as Professor Maria, Anna Maria De Silva mentioned. But the effect of ice is you put a more or less a level thermal ice cover across the channel. Flow resistance is greatest in here and less here. So the flow concentrates out here and tends to erode. And you have problems then with undercutting geotechnical stability of the bank, which I'll show you in the next slide. So the inside may also be filled with slush. And so you get these scour holes formed, which again, you've got to be out there in wintertime to detect them, because when you go back after spring or early summer, they're backfilled and they're hard to determine what exactly has happened. This is a bend in the Missouri River, and again, the Fort Peck Reach, which experiences a high flow and an unnatural flow during wintertime. We monitor this bend and a number of other sites along the river over one or two winters. For one winter, we had our video camera positioned here, and the bank shifted, the channel shifted that much and undercut the bank that we had to move the camera in a bit to make it more stable. So bank erosion is a big concern. Another factor with channel stability, and we don't often think of thermal effects on channel stability, but thermal effects can be very important. This is a south-facing bank. South-facing banks are more vulnerable than north-facing banks because they get a lot of insulation during the day. And you can see, I don't have another slide that shows the plastic deformation of these banks. You get cracks, and then they cantilever out, and you get the flow undercutting the toe. So there's a lot of dynamic activity during winter time. The flow distribution changes too. We don't get these large sort of helical flow pattern, single helical flow pattern that Professor De Silva showed. We get two weaker ones. Lab experiments have shown this. They don't. The streamwise flow erosion and concentration of flow has a greater erosive effect. But what I like about this picture, it combines the hydraulics and the geomechanical effects. So when we look at bank stability and channel shifting, it's not, we must also look at the bank material. If you've got weak bank material, like along the Missouri River in eastern Montana, the channel shifts very, very readily. So we have, again, with, say, a sinuous braided channel, like this in open water condition, you may have a couple of tarwicks going around like this. When we get ice flow, these lower areas, or shallow areas, tend to fill in and we get a more sinuous path. You can look at the, I don't have a figure here, but Professor Shum is a classic figure of different channel morphologies for slope and so forth. You can use the change in channel slope to explain how the morphology might change. The biggest effect, perhaps, is tharwick shift, where a major blockage occurs in one branch, and then the flow is forced to go around the other branch. In this case, I've got this figure, which is upside, wrong way around, but this was the major channel through a tharwick in the Laramie River. I have a similar couple of figures for the Missouri River. But this froze up and forced the flow through here. This is exactly the same as with the Vistula River that Professor Majewski was talking about on Tuesday. One branch, the main branch, got a jam, the flow is forced sideways, and all of a sudden you've got another major tharwick has shifted. So the destabilizing effect of ice and shifting the tharwick around is important. This is perhaps the most important effect of ice in terms of go on. The effects of ice in terms of ice breakup, dynamic breaking front like this on the Leeard River in British Columbia, you can see the jam plowing down almost like a surge, flexing up the edge of the ice cover and breaking it. So north flowing rivers often have a problem like this, and regulated rivers, particularly if they're used for peaking hydropower, can create problems like this. So when you operate a peaking hydropower plant on an ice cover river, you've got to be very careful how you manage the ice cover as well. So we have an ice run like this, typical. This is in the Peace River in Alberta. There are other wonderful photographs of ice runs on the Yenisei and Ob River, some of the classic Russian rivers that flow into the Arctic, north flowing, a very dynamic effect. So we have major ice runs like this, and notice the bank condition here. In Russian, we get what's called a Veshevnik. My apologies to Russian speakers if I get the Russian wrong. We have a Veshevnik, the vegetation is altered. This is along the Susitna River in Alaska. So the vegetation, you don't get larger plants. They don't survive here. You get this grading. Veshevniks were very useful in the earlier days for horses and men pulling boats upstream. You had this path cleared along the river that you could have a team of horses pulling boats upstream. So this is the Susitna River in Alaska. We have a Veshevnik formation on the side, and I'll come back to this, but this is a feature of many rivers that experience dynamic ice cover breakup. The vegetation along such rivers differs, as I indicate. So this is an ice-free channel. You'd have bushes and so forth here, on the sort of lower floodplain, perhaps. On an ice-affected channel, all those are removed. You just have grasses and so forth. So the ecology of an ice-affected channel different than an ice-free channel. Here is a view of a Missouri River down in the Fort Peck Reach where you can see where the ice cover was. On the Fort Peck Reach, the flow is fairly steady in wintertime, so the ice can freeze into the bank. When it breaks and leaves,
this case, it plucks out the grasses and leaves a band like this. You can see at least an exposed area. The ecology of ice-affected channels differs from ice-free channels. Vertical scour, vertical contraction in the scour underneath the toe of an ice jam is a common concern. More work to be done on this problem too. Channel ice effects on cutoffs and sedimentation of floodplains is an area that needs more documentation. This is again the Missouri River, Fort Peck Reach, River Mile 1599. A jam formed in here blocked this, wouldn't go around the bend, and so the flow just cut the neck of this narrow section of channel, as you can see here. However, if the neck is rather wide, it does not cut. The jam formed in here, this tight bend, and you can see the bend is threatening a railroad line through here. So the water level backed up, and the water and sediment just flowed over the floodplain part of the bend here, and deposited sediment. So you get a buildup of the bank, of the floodplain material here. So a message I'd like to leave with you: ice destabilizes. It doesn't necessarily leave a signature that you can point to and say, simply the Beshevnik on the vegetation effect. This is a channel that has ice. Ice just destabilizes. It destabilizes mainly on multi-channel units. This is the two views of the middle Susitna reach. This is the Susitna, which goes from mountains here, Mount Denali around here. The middle reach is of particular interest. The end of the upper reach is where this large hydropower dam is planned. It's been on again, off again. Large amount of study going on the effect of the hydropower dam on the middle reach. The middle reach ends where two other rivers, the Talkeetna and the Tulitna, flow into the Susitna, and we have a wider braided channel, and the flow is about increased 2.5 times, and the effect of ice is not at all clear. But the main area of concern is the middle reach. Middle reach has got single channel stretches like this, or multi-channel stretches or units like this. So with a single channel, as indicated here, and rather narrowish floodplain, flow is constrained. You can see the Beshevnik effects along here. And so ice will clear this out. The biggest effects of ice are multi-channel, where you've got, like I showed on the previous figure, ice will form a jam here, perhaps, and force the flow around that way. So you find the flopping of channels, very important. You'll find the impact of ice on vegetation, very important. Here is a series from the winter of 2012 and 2013 of one particular location to illustrate this. A small jam formed locally. The main highway went through here. This is a side branch. So the flow backs up. And the flow is forced to go around. This is over almost 4 years ago, in May. This is the time of dynamic breakup in the Susitna. So the flow over about a day or two then gradually moves around here, and that widens out, and you see flow, ice as well as water going through here. So the Thalweg starts to shift. It may still go back to the main channel, but this channel gets enlarged, and trees get removed along the way. Here is a view, again, in the winter of another spot on the Susitna River. You see where the ice at higher levels and has plowed over the banks of this island of vegetated bars. It's removed trees, as you can see here. This is the area here viewed in early fall. So you can see the effects of ice on disturbing the channels and certainly disturbing the vegetation. I think the big effects on vegetation, which we do not know. The analogy that I like to use is the glass half full, perhaps, where you have water half full of the glass, and you add ice, you quickly fill the glass without increasing the water discharge, perhaps. And if you swirl it, you have a very abrasive mix, higher flow and ice pieces hitting the sides of the glass. You can tell by the clinking of the glass the energy that goes into that. So it's the effect of ice and high flows together. Raise the flow, give these abrasive chunks of ice that move along the channel, they hit the banks, but you also see ice impacts on trees, you see ice scars on trees, and net effect in terms of change of vegetation. So, and I'm coming to the end of my talk, and I may have gone too fast. I don't know. Anyway, you're doing really much. Here we are near Warsaw. Don't forget Jack Frost. Don't forget ice. There's a major effect. I want to touch on one, first of all, just some topics of research, and then I want to touch on one more, go to Lake Michigan, one large lake effect. A long list of topics for research in this subject area. Ice formation, how it actually occurs in rivers. I'm embarrassed to say, after 40, 50, 60 years, we don't really know accurately. We don't know this part in particular because we can't see it. It occurs in the Vistula River, it occurs in the big rivers, but you can't see it. We need proper instrumentation, the right instrumentation. Anchorized transport of bed material is another topic of research. Ice effects on channel morphology needs to be explored further. The combined effects of river ice and permafrost, and I haven't spoken about permafrost, which you go further north, you get permafrost effects, which do have a signature of channel morphology. The ecological effects of river ice are very important. As I mentioned, instrumentation methods to overcome the difficulties we have with access, very important. CFD always and increasingly has a role helping us understand what happens. Also, I want to go leave with a kind of a, give you a sense of how powerful, it's one of the most intriguing things to me with regard to fluid mechanics or hydraulics, how a very delicate process can be so robust. It's to do with anchor ice again. And this is a problem area that we have in the United States. This is Lake Michigan. And weather conditions, by and large, we get cold weather coming down from the north, northwest across Lake Michigan. And so the ice preferentially forms on the eastern side. We've got more complicated ice accumulation along the nearshore area here. But from Chicago, Barrie, Indiana, Chicago, Milwaukee, and so forth up through here, we have a lot of water intakes. This side of Lake Michigan is relatively shallow. Water intakes have to go out to some depth. And I had on the slide, I forgot to mention the Modin-Obukhov, named after two very good Russian physicists, the Modin-Obukhov length, which is the length to which a mechanical-driven turbulence, say through wind in the case of a lake, dominates over buoyancy-driven turbulence. If you get below this depth in the lake, then buoyancy effects become more important than the turbulence associated with wind effects on the top. And so, if you do calculations of the Modin-Obukhov length for Lake Michigan, that length or depth is about 30 meters. Many water intakes along here are 10 meters, 5 meters, 25 meters. And they have problems with ice. This is another problem we have these days. This is a new type of water intake. This is a water intake in Lake Michigan. The picture is not so clear, but I want to explain a couple of things. This is a cylindrical drum water intake. And so this is the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency in the United States, requires new intakes and older ones to be retrofitted with these intakes, which have got a kind of a screen mesh. The idea is to keep small fish and biota from being drawn in with the water drawn to the power plant or municipal water supply. Turns out these are wonderful devices for growing ice. And so you can see here at a depth of maybe about 10 meters, this fantastic anchor ice forming here. You can see how the crystals get quite large. They get as large as your hand or larger. This is another view. This is the intake on one side. You see the crystal growth here. This crystal grows if there is super cold water coming down this 10 meter depth of lake. This is another view. Give you a sense of crystals. So this intake is clogged with ice. Other pictures I have show the end buckled in because of the suction. And so a major problem there's another close-up of the crystal structures. So a major problem for many water intakes, hydraulic engineering problem for water intakes along the western seaboard of Lake Michigan is blockage of intakes by ice. And these intakes are some depth. How to advise intake operators have asked, well, what should we do? Can we, these intakes, I should add, are something like 300 meters offshore, 500 meters offshore to get deep enough water. You can't have a person out there, you can't really put a cable out there very readily and have a signal. So the only option at the moment is to monitor the water level within the intake structure on land itself. When it starts to go down, you think, uh-oh, we're starting to get blockage effects, and then to ease back, reduce the amount of water into the intake structure. So I'll end on this slide. This is my last slide. I'll end on the slide with this. Again, the subject involves abrasive effects from ice impacting against banks and bridge piers and so forth, but also very subtle effects. How that supercool water gets from the water depth 10 meters above down to the crystals that form here and feeds the crystals long enough to grow to this size and block is a very interesting fluid mechanic and hydraulic engineering problem. Doesn't lend itself easily to lab work. Field work is difficult. Analytical work may have to be used, or a combination of approaches needed. So that ends my presentation, about 20 minutes early. But all to say that for me, I didn't plan 36 or so years to go to make a career in ice, but I find it so fascinating. All these effects that come into play, and the wealth of research that yet to be done. Thank you. Thank you.
I see an enthusiastic questioner here.
Yes, very fascinating talk. I find only one way to excuse myself from knowing very little about ice formation, and it is, of course, that I come from Italy, so we don't have much of that. But one question that comes to my mind is that some time ago, talking to a colleague, he mentioned the fact that the inner part, the water part, the bottom part of the ice cover, could actually be sometimes quite rough, rather than smooth, as we may think of. Yes. Can you comment on the roughness scale, or if anything is known about such a thing, or whether it is the rocks being picked up that could create some roughness or something?
Yes, I think when you get the initial cover may be rather rough, the accumulation cover, but then the thermal growing smooth things out and you get a smooth cover. And then at the time of warmer water coming into the river, warmer water on that freezing surface, you can get quite fascinating too, are these ice dunes, undulations. They're not really dunes as we think of dunes accumulating, but they are at the interface, the instability of the interface gives a waveform called ice dunes. And they occur just before breakup, and we have sort of warmer runoff water coming in, and so the water under the ice cover is maybe 1 degree Celsius, or say two perhaps, but it's warm enough to start interacting or playing with that face, and then you get this undulation, which somehow there's an optimization between the flow resistance and the heat transfer and so forth. And there's some wonderful papers on that subject. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. There is often channel flow changes to pressurized flow. Yes. When the ice is over, the friction factor is changed too.
The friction factor definitely has changed. It's not not a pressurized.
Boundary friction factor.
Yes, that's this is always one of the uncertainties. But it's not a pressurized flow, because typically, unless the flow is very steady, maybe from downstream of a hydro power plant, then it might freeze to the bank. But typically, it's like a floating lid on the cup.
Yes, but if you see the ice is very easy.
It'll move up and down, and if the flow is steady, then there's enough time for the ice to freeze to the bank. Then you can't.
But how is the reach?
Yeah, no, it's like, think of it as like a floating lid on the channel floor. But anything can happen.
Anything can happen.
I wanted to indicate about, for example, you can't use fruit number for...
No, you can still use fruit number as a proximate indicator of things, but it's a covered flow, and the flow, the boundary and some resistance, and so the flow level goes up for sure. So some good work done by Canadians and Russians on ice resistance.
Okay. Similar to Andrea, I'm also fascinated, but not only today, but starting from yesterday after our talk. Can you say something about how can you measure in what temperature this anchoring occurs? So is it technically possible at this moment? And another question, maybe not related to this very much, but when you have an ice jam or the ice cover, how can you evaluate the roughness of the ice from below? So there, are there any techniques available right now, or it's completely open question? I'm ignorant.
So I'll answer the first question first. So we have this stuff called anchor ice, which is like a coral growth on the bed of a typical alluvial river. The best conditions for an anchor ice growth are cold, clear nights, maybe with a bit of wind. And so the water without much seed material around, and usually early winter is not so good because there's still enough moisture around and the fog. Get into early winter, with the warm early winter, cold, clear night, and the water temperature at the surface super cools, maybe about 100 or 200 degrees Celsius, and that's buoyant. It's lighter than the water below, but then through turbulence it gets mixed. So we're not sure what it looks like, and again these mixing processes occur much faster than thermal exchange processes. So the blobs, not sure if they're filaments or blobs or what they are, get mixed into the water column. This is where the Mononwabukov length is very important, particularly for lakes, maybe more so than small rivers and streams. So you get some frazzle ice crystals forming, and what ice in super cold water, I forgot to mention, is very adhesive. It sticks to trash bags and hydraulic structures, so it sticks to anything you put on the bed here. So you get these crystals forming here, and then you get a feeding of super cold water, so the crystals grow. Before you know it, they're very big, and they get bigger and bigger, and they envelop something, and then the buoyancy lifts it off, and it moves along. And so, cold, clear night, super cooling, and then when the ice forms, it releases latent heat effusion from that, and bring it back up to zero. On a snowy night, where you've got a lot of seed material and snowflakes, it doesn't really super cool much. And so you don't really get, you may get anchor ice. It's remarkably robust. This is what I find so fascinating. It forms, but not like big crystals. So the crystal morphology changes depending on the snow or the clear night.
But the velocity influences things?
Velocity, it can be swift, it can be, it usually forms first on gravel and cobbles. It has trouble when it hits sand pieces are harder to lift very quickly. So and eventually it may get trapped in behind a dune and get enveloped by big falls. And vegetation, reeds, plants, it sticks to. With regard to the roughness on the underside, I think you can calculate back out.
Okay.
Yeah. Some sort of estimate. Typically, these covers can be rather three-dimensional in their form, so it's rather complicated still. You know, in my career, which is about 35, 6, 7 years, our generation really, we've come to really get a better handle on turbulence, which we tended to brush off as something we could hardly see or measure or just treat as noise. So now, to Professor Silver's presentation, now we know there's something going on with this turbulence, and we have the instrumentation and better insight to measure these things. And so, same with ice three-dimensional effects. We have more than the CFD or the instrumentation in the lab to better understand what's going on, deal with the complexities more than we could do, say, 60 years ago, 50 years ago, 40 years ago. 60 years ago, what instruments did we have for measuring turbulence? What do we have? We had hot film anemometer, which was a pesky thing, sensitive. You collected a lot of data. What did you do with the data? You had to write it down by hand, or you had a very primitive computer. Now we can deal with lots of data and some better instrumentation.
If I could just add a couple of words in the discussion about roughness. We've noticed that the roughness of ice is very high, like.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to invite our next speaker, Tomasz Kolerski from Gdańsk University of Technology, Poland. His presentation is about numerical modeling of water and ice dynamics.
Ksenia, professor, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to be here and present something, especially because it's an ice session. It hasn't been for long, and I'm very glad to participate in that. My speech today is partly about ice, and the story behind it is we want to show some utilization of our numerical analysis and scientific analysis to be employed in the engineering aspects. Specifically, we're talking about bridge interaction, and the goal for this was to check how the bridge affect the hydrodynamic condition in the direct vicinity of the piers, and also how the piers affect the ice transport together with opposite effect, how the ice actually affect on the piers. I'm glad that Professor Etema mentioned about this to be one of the hot issues related to the ice, the very suns, because the load and possible jamming caused by the bridge is kind of possibility which may happen all around the world, of course, where the ice events are observed. The background for this is that the new bridge is going to be constructed, is actually under construction, is the highway bridge, as you see on this sketch. We have existing bridge, and downstream, slightly downstream, about 30 meters down, it's designed and now under construction, a new highway bridge, which has two piers inside the Vistula River. Is pretty much estuary of Vistula River, however, it's not the catwalk channel, which Professor Majewski explained to you people at the very beginning. And the main span of the bridge has 130 meter width and is located on the waterway. There are a number of important facts related to that, but I will talk about one by one. First of all, the ground when the bridge is supposed to be placed is weak, therefore we need deep foundation. Original idea was to have prefabricated Larsen, Franke-type piles, but to lower the cost, there was idea about micro piles, and one of the proposition was to keep this structural formworks in form of Larsen sheet piling to be exposed over the water level, just to extend the resistance of the pier. So we model a number of cases. The piers, as it's shown here, the piers with the large foot, as shown here, and also cofferdams, but specifically that case was only considered without ice phenomena, because that was only a short period of time when the cofferdams were installed. All right, hydrodynamic calculation was made by my co-author. However, there was shallow water equation, as shown here, with all these matrices and the vectors presented. And the solution for that was finite volume method and explicit two-step finite difference scheme. Okay. There was a calculation, as I told you, about the copper dams, which looks like this. There was only a short period of time when the copper dams was installed. Behind that was actually construction of the pier going on. After the short period of time when the piles was put in place, it was removed, and the remaining part looks like this. This is the last year photo. Right. The results of the study, by applying this mathematical model, numerical solution, show that water levels are as shown on this figure. We're just presenting a case with the copper dams and the large piers together with the existing bridge with some effect, of course, caused by the copper dams, together with velocity distribution and velocity magnitude. The reason to check the hydrodynamics, of course, was to estimate the range for the possible erosion of the bottom and extended bed erosion. However, we didn't really check the amount of scouring. We just showed the zones when velocity is high. Of course, we need to have initial bathymetry before we start this study, and how it looks here. And after bridge piers was constructed, it was detailed bathymetry done, shown some scouring around the piers, reaching, well, this is elevation, so I just show you the difference plot, which shows the erosion up to about 6 meters close to the piers here in this place. All right, so now I will move on to the ice dynamics stuff, which I feel more comfortable. We used the dynarize model, which is quite recognizable. I have the privilege to work with Han Tao Shen to develop this code for a period of time. And the code, the river ice dynamics, is actually modeled based on the second law of dynamics. You see the acceleration multiplied by mass equal to summation of forces. And the forces is internal resistance, wind drag, water drag, and gravitational force. Right. When we go to the ice to structure interaction and we consider differential elements of ice rubble in contact with structure which is stationary, we can derive summation forces, including internal resistance forces, reaction force, water drag, wind drag, and slope effect. Right. We may notice that number of these terms are second derivatives, so could be neglected, the higher order terms, and we finally get to the point when, well, we have to also find the forces normal dimension to the direction, which will look like this. We only have internal resistance effect in both of this equation, and final equation showing the normal tangential force looks like this. We have strength, concentration, and ice thickness. Okay. Results, we model a number of scenarios. However, we know that ice events could be dangerous and problematic. in case of low flow condition and average flow condition, because the high flow condition probably sweep all the ice down without contact with the piers, which actually was proved by the simulations. This plot shows thickness distribution according to this scale. It's not significant, it's about 0.65 meters. However, what's important, initial thickness of single piece of ice in this case was 0.2 meters. And on this plot, I show the load, which is line load per meter, showing the normal and yeah, that's just normal, sorry. I didn't present tangential, but they are not such significant. Force on the new piers and existing piers. This is the situation after 1 day of simulation, well, 1 day simulation time. And some may ask if that's equilibrium state. Well, it's all dynamics. However, I show you the picture showing the parcels moving on, and it's actually kind of constant situation. It's still moving, but not producing any higher force. It's just showing 12 hours. So the scale is different color, but pretty much show the same. All right, and this is the case with average flow condition, which is about 1,000 cubic meter per second, showing that the forces are reaching 1 kilonewton per meter in the upstream side of the new piers. Existing piers also experience some effect of the ice, however, because they are smaller, they're not really taking too much force on it. As I said, this was only one of the options with the large piers. The final construction turned out to be actually a series of two identical piers, which has same width as the existing pier, or let's say old piers, right? And the load are significantly lowered. However, it may be possible that in case of high concentration of ice moving down in this section, it may be stopped by the existing bridge, which happened before. And that's why we have icebreakers operating every season. Well, if needed, some season we don't have a significant ice event and the icebreakers are not even moving from the port to clean the ice. But it is expected that this practice will be continued in the future. Right. This is just a picture showing how during the construction the ice phenomena look like. You see, of course, some barge. So there's not the final condition, but the shape of the pier is exactly the same as we have in our numerical simulations. You see some accumulation, mostly because of this barge, not the pier, because on this side ice is moving clearly down without stoppage. However, some accumulation at the upstream side of the pier could be observed with, like, I can estimate 2 or 3 ice pieces overlapping on each other, right, in different perspective. All right, sorry. So just jump to conclusion. We may just say that this tool could be very useful and helpful for supporting decisions, especially on the planning or designing level. However, I need to strongly say that this is all related, especially the ice simulation, on our experience, because the boundary conditions are always weak points. We don't know exactly how will happen in each year. I have a number of previous simulations when I could calibrate some parameters, but this may change in the future season. So thank you very much. I will be very happy to have some questions.
Thank you for the interesting presentation. Does anyone have any questions?
I can speak louder.
Okay.
So the pier had vertical sides, is that right?
Yes.
Why not have a sloped side to get work with weakest force and strength device?
I guess I cannot answer this question because that was just a project, like how they want to build it. They just asked if this dies. Maybe the answer is that was behind existing piers, so they don't expect, it's about 30 meters behind existing piers, so they don't expect significant or large flows going into the new piers. I may think it may be the reason.
Yeah. So the ice loads were not significant?
At that case, not.
And for the design, the ice loads were not significant, is that correct?
Yes.
Any questions? Thank you again for interesting presentation. And our next speaker is Ayazana Badarch from Nagaoka University of Technology. His presentation is about numerical simulations of the melting and floating ice.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for having me here, and it's a great moment to be with you and presenting my research. Today I'm going to talk about lattice-Boltzmann method for the melting and floating of ice. Ice is common in cold region, and in this animation we see ice breakup process, and the interesting thing is sediment is induced by ice and usually, but in this presentation we only consider ice in open channel flow. Ice in open channel flow consists of involves free surface flow, heat transport, liquid solid phase transition, and moving body. To cover all these physical phenomena, we propose a thermal free surface immersed boundary lattice-Boltzmann method, which consists of two models, namely free surface flow modeling and heat transport with phase change modeling. And we are working on the 2D numerical model, and here we see grids and lattices for two models, and each set in computational grid we have an indication of matrix such as G for air, I for free surface, F for fluid, and there also indication for the ice and water to distinguish these two regions, and we solve two discretized Boltzmann equation for fluid flow and scattered transport, which is temperature field. So with the distribution function, we can define fluid variables such as density, velocity, and temperature with this formula. And in order to account liquid-solid phase transition, we define liquid fraction value based on the enthalpy update. And these two models, I mean free surface and liquid solid phase transition, couples each other based on some parameters as well as non-Poisson-esque approximation for density deviation. So I would like to explain a little about free surface treatment in lattice-Boltzmann method. And free surface is presented by transformation of interface IF cells with its mass evolution on it. A mass-conserving equation is discretized into each cell in terms of mesoscopic scale like this. And treatment of free surface is single phase model, which means we don't consider air, and the air leaves the boundary condition on the interfaces like this. And another important thing is floating of ice. Ice in the water is a time-dependent arbitrary shaped floating body, because the shape is arbitrary and shape changes over time. And more importantly, there is a physical properties inside the ice, for example, internal energy or temperature field, simply. And then we are proposing a numerical algorithm based on the immersive boundary permutation, and we inserted new terms to the equations, like submerged volumetric percent and integral center of gravity. This modification maintains correct computation of forces and mass, conserves mass. This is our main program of numerical code. Free surface model is followed by a transport model where we track a motion of the ice. And I want to show some validation. This is the 1D Stefan problem, describes the melting of ice. And we have an analytical solution here. And in this figure, we see temperature distribution in time advance, and also melting front positions. And Lattice Boltzmann method gives a very nice solution for the melting interface. And also here in this figure, we compare temperature distribution at four times and at four positions, and predictions were very good comparing to the analytical solution. So also I want to show one validation for free surface flow. We conducted a tambourine experiment, and we considered two grid resolution to check grid independency. And in this figure, we compare time evolution of waterfront position. Of course, a fine grid gives more correct result. And here we compare time evolution of water level at two points. From this validation work, we found